Father, be with us. Thank you for the fact that we have hope and that you have sent your Son who has become our Savior and who, as we come to him, we come to light and understanding. And we just ask that you will guard my mind, my thoughts, my words, that you would give us understanding this morning. In your name, amen. Okay, I'm just going to grab my trusty sword, which is a little bigger now than it used to be since I've become a new fan of this. Let me just say to you a couple of things in the beginning, and it's this. This is not a class defending the authority of Scripture. I am assuming, because you're here and you're interested in what the Bible says about the future, that you are going to trust that we're going to look at Scripture and find out what the Scripture says. The reason I say that is if we were to do a defense of Scripture, we would have a class in bibliology and it would be an apologetic class and we would do some defenses here and there. I am 100% reliant in my own thinking and my commitment, and I believe Christians down through the ages would share this with me, that this word, this book is reliable. And in not just being reliable, it is authoritative. And that's the trick. You can think it's reliable, but by your attitude, behave as if it's not authoritative in your life. So we're going to try and take a look at some of the things. You can see some quotes there in the front. I want to begin by saying, I came to Jesus because I was afraid to go to hell. I was brought up in a Christian home. You already met my husband this morning, so my background was similar, not identical. But I was taught the genuine Word of God. I was taught who Jesus was. I was taught to respect Scripture. I was taught to value the cross. I was taught very, very deeply, so that even when I went to a secular university, it didn't bother me that there were teachings in my biology, first year biology, of other ways of the origin or the beginnings of the earth. And I just thought, this has got to be a joke. You'd be camping out your brain to believe that. Now that's how good the job was that my parents did on teaching me that this book is the final word on everything. So. But I didn't trust Jesus. Many people who come through a Christian home trust Jesus. They'll say, well, somewhere about 4 or 5, or I can't remember, and I just heard about the cross, and I believed. In fact, some of them will say, well, I'm a Christian all their life. I try and say, no, that's not possible. If you're born dead, there's got to be a point where you're made alive. Well, for me, it was at 13, after a year and a half of difficult, intense conviction of sin. And I'm not sure I'd done that many, big, bad, horrible sins. I just had enough sin to keep me out of heaven. And so I remember the 1956, the 5 missionaries were killed in Ecuador. That caught my mind. Missions were very important. My brother had just left to go to South America to be a lifetime missionary. And I can remember staring for long periods of time at the open Vancouver sun, realizing these people died for the gospel, these 5. And they left the family. If any of you remember pictures of that time, the 5 widows sitting around a table in Shell or in Quito, not sure which of the places. And they were just processing the shock of death. And from January of 1956 until November 1957, I battled within, was torment within. I wanted to go to heaven. I didn't think I was a Christian by this time. I knew I wasn't born again. I hadn't been made alive in Christ. So I would listen in the morning if I woke up early, and I often did, to see if my parents were still breathing after the morning. Well, maybe Jesus had come and I didn't want to be left behind. I'm telling you this because that was... That was the motivation that drew me, that pushed me, that finally brought me to rest in the completion and satisfaction that God the Father had with the Son's atonement on the cross. Now, did I understand all those things then? No. I think if you were a fly in the wall, you would have listened to me and my Father reading to me, John 3:36. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life, but the wrath of God abides on him. I already knew something was abiding on me that didn't feel that great. And I didn't want to go to a place where there was going to be more of it. And so I remember getting down on my knees on 41st Avenue, a little house up in the top story, with my parents with me. And it was a humbling experience because I fought the Spirit's work. Listen, you don't have to be old to fight the Spirit's work. And I just called out, Father. Now, I know you're thinking, well, didn't you say the good prayer? I mean, all of us who are good campus crusaders know you've got to pray the sinner's prayer or NAVs or I mean, all of us. We know there's certain things you say when you pray to receive Jesus. No, I just was calling Father. I feel like at that time, or I sense at that time, I finally understood. And the first cry of any baby who knows his father is to say, Daddy. So I was saved and taken from the kingdom of darkness, and I was brought into the kingdom of light. So the riding motivation, if you were to say, how did you come to know Jesus? I came because I was afraid to go to hell, and I wanted to go to heaven, to a point that I would be nervous if I came home and my parents weren't there. I'd wonder if the rapture had occurred, or, I mean, all those things. And you may have heard people, you may have felt that way yourself at some point in time. So coming to Jesus, November 5th, 1957, was for me the evening of new birth. And some of you may not be able to give a time or a date. That's not my concern. My concern is, do you know, are you trusting Jesus now? That would be what I would ask you. Are you trusting in his substitution on the cross? And I did mention that the five missionaries caught my attention as a 12-year-old because I was amazed that someone would actually die for the sake of the gospel. So the work of the Spirit of God to convict me of sin, that's what he does, so that I will trust, because see, hell and the future, heaven, it's all about where the sin is. So my if I were to tell you my conversion verse is John 3:36, the one my father read to me. He who believes in the Son has, its present tense, life. And he who does not believe in the Son of God does not have the life. And the wrath of God, now you've got to understand this because this will impact our whole morning. The wrath of God abides, present tense, on him. So what I wanted to say by telling you that about my story is I have tried hard to squeeze some things in this morning so that in your package you will have no fill-ins. The details are already there. So if I don't get through the morning, you still have that. You can go home and study. If I don't defend Scripture to you, I've already said I'm not going to defend it. I believe that this book is authoritative. It is complete. It's inspired. It's infallible. It's inerrant in the original text. It is expected to implicate my life. And the goal for this weekend is I need to submit to it with joy, because that's where peace is found and rest and hope. And so if I disappoint you about not going to this other than to give you some verses, then you will need to come back another time for a class in apologetics, all right? Now, I think if somebody could just give me your copy, there's a picture at the front that I want to just look at. If I could just look at that quickly, I want to, okay, thank you. Sarah, you'll have to get another one. Oh, yeah, it's the back page. We are not going to necessarily, we don't have time, we're not going to do it. We're not going to go through this. So I just want to tell you, anytime you ask yourself a question that the Bible can answer, you need to be able to go from what God has said to an understanding. So this graph at the back is what I would suggest is a good way for you to begin to Train your mind to think. God has revealed truth. The Word of God says it's self-authenticating. It says a lot of things about itself. The writers say things about it. If you want to know what the Bible says about itself, in that whether or not it has any effect in your life, read the 150 verses in Psalm 119. Every verse addresses the truth of God's Word and how it changes yours, or Psalm 19, 7 to 11. So when you're asking, well, what does God say about the future? What does God say about our human existence? What does he say? Whatever. That God has revealed, now, truth. Now, he's revealed truth in that he may not have said everything he could say. That's what gets us into trouble and into heresy. But if God's word is true, all scripture is God-breathed and it's profitable. That's Paul to Timothy. Peter will say, the writers of scripture didn't get into a dream some night and think, I'd like to think of, and begin to write, but they were moved by the Spirit. It's God the Spirit who's directing their pen and their thoughts. And so God's truth, it comes to us not exhaustively, in that we know everything there is to know. If we did, we'd be God, and we're not. But it does give us exactly what we need to know. So Peter will say we've got everything we need for life and godliness. Deuteronomy 29:29 would say, well, the secret things belong to God, but the things he's revealed to us, he's revealed to us and our children. So there is a point, and you're going to have to be happy with God at this point, because it's the way it is. He hasn't told you everything he knows, but he's told you everything you need to know in order to go to heaven and to stay out of hell. And he's told you everything you need to know on how to live in the world he's created. I mean, he's given us everything we need to know. So that's what we say, meaning when we say God's revealed truth. Now, you can look at the second. Sometimes he helps us with images in terms of literary devices such as metaphors. Now, that's certainly true on the topic of what comes after life. Very many pictures are used. And I'm going to try and give you a basis for you to understand that if something says where the worm doesn't die and the fire is not quenched, our little minds will say, does that mean it's worms all over? Or is that hot fire? Or what is it, like the burning bush? I mean, we go crazy with it. And part of it is that there is a picture here that the writers are doing their best, and the Lord Jesus himself, who uses this language, is describing a place called hell in a way that, apart from him describing it, we wouldn't get how horrible it is. So that there is a point where imagery is used, and there are many ways of describing. So not everybody says it the same way. A Gehenna, the garbage dump of Jerusalem, is often used about in the same way. So heaven, same way. If you start looking at pictures of heaven, you get John's picture in the book of the Revelation. You get Paul's picture, which is a white picture. Have you ever thought of Paul's picture of heaven? It's like a white, it's like a snowstorm. There's just snow. Because he said, no, I wasn't allowed to say anything about it, but I was caught. And things I couldn't believe would be true. And he will later say it hasn't even entered in the mind of man what God's prepared. So there are pictures, there's hyperbole, there's all these things that you have to hold in your hand when we're talking about God's revealed truth. Long as you understand that when it's revealed as truth, he's not saying it's just an idea, it's truth, but we think in pictures so that we better understand. God's storybook, he's illustrated it, so we have many witnesses giving witness to some of these major things. There's a little bit given in the Old Testament, and then that it's widened and broadened. The picture of the future, of the afterlife, is very skimpy. It's there, but it's not as well developed in the Old Testament, which is quite appropriate because the Bible was never meant to be just read as 39 books and you leave out the other 27, and it was never meant to be reading the 27 and leaving out the first 39. You wouldn't do that to a love. If Gary sent me, I'm hoping he'll send me a nice card today. I'm not going to read the last page or the last piece of it. It's not going to make sense. It's going to be Carlton, US, $299, Canada, $350. That is not going to give me the whole picture. So when it comes to understanding, I need to make sure I'm looking at the story and we have less in the old and we have more explained in the new. And then finally, how your story, and I've given you my story this morning on my experience with the topic, the afterlife, thinking about heaven and hell, and how I came to understand it, and how God's word answered my questions. Now, at a later time, when you go back to your home or you have a free afternoon, that will be the time that you could put the topic or some of the words that we addressed this morning in that that graph. That's simply meant to be a discipline for you to begin to think. That's how you begin to look at Scripture and you let Scripture speak. All right? So let me go ahead and get you to look at the quotes on the front. These are just a few. I want to recommend a couple of books at the beginning, and then I'm going to do the PowerPoint. But I'd like to recommend, it's called Hell Under Fire, a very good book. Some of my professors from Trinity Seminary are in here. Dr. Packer, I took a course on God from him. He's in at Regent College. This is a helpful book because it answers a lot of questions. Hell Under Fire, it's got two general editors, Christopher Morgan and Robert Peterson. Another, there's just three that I'm going to recommend this morning that I feel would be, if I were to say, here's some places for you to start if you are wanting to think beyond where you've been in terms of the post-life of any human being. This is Dr. Pine. Bob Pine was my systematic theology core teacher at Dallas Seminary. Humanity and Sin, great practical book, answers a lot of the questions as well. And each of these, the one on Hell Under Fire comes at it a little more theologically. Bob has a great way of writing. You might enjoy that. And then this is, these are some of the quotes I've given you, Sense and Nonsense About Heaven and Hell. Basically, Kenneth Boa and Bob Bowman. Now, the main idea that I think I came to learn, I need to tell you, I was on a learning curve preparing for this, and I came to understand some things, and I'm just going to show them to you this morning. They're up behind you. These are not in your notes. I understand now the picture isn't what happens after death. The picture is what is my origin? And if you don't begin with the image of God in your life, and I need to say this about every doctrine that I've come to know and love. When I'm studying a particular, there are 10 doctrines that would fit into systematic theology. I fall in love with that doctrine at that time. And then, of course, I move on and think I need to be not a drum pounder where I'm only talking about one thing all the time. Have you met people like that? They can only talk about one thing. Well, that's probably because they're in love with that right now. They've finally understood some things. This is what I would want to recommend that you think about. The implications for life, death, and eternity is that we are made in the image of God. So I need to come to grips. I am not like the animals. I can't stand and say, well, it depends. You know, I think this happens after death. Well, no, that doesn't happen if you're made in the image of God. It may happen if you're made as an animal or a fish or a tree. But it isn't if you're made human being. So we have worth, we have dignity, we reflect God's handiwork inside and out. And you'd have to go back to Genesis 1-3 and read this. And that's why I said, this isn't a Bible teaching morning in the same way. You're going to have to trust that there are passages that tell us, I am fearfully and wonderfully made, Psalm 139. And God's word speaks to this. But I refuse God's ways. And I require God's redemption. So this is the whole issue of the fall and sin. But I'm also responsible to God with how people are responsible, how they treated Jesus, how they treat Jesus. This will be crucial. And then someday I'm going to give an account in terms to God for sin. And so we are told that that at some point, there will come a day of judgment. There will come a day where I stand before God, and I'm going to stand and give an account of my life. So if you're thinking of what in the world happens after I die, you need to think you're made in the image of God. That's where you start. That's the revealed truth. Then you move from there. You don't start thinking backwards. Well, so-and-so says this, so-and-so said this 150 years ago, so-and-so said this, and then that had to get changed because what was said here, and you begin to maneuver God's word to fit or to try and fit, and then it doesn't fit. That's how heresy starts. So we begin with what God says. So here we are. Human beings have a model for life, death, and eternity. And so it's not just in a generic way I'm made in the image of God, but I have a paradigm. I have a pattern. I have a hero. I have a man, Christ Jesus, who came in flesh. Did you ever think about this? One of the oldest books in the Bible is Job. One of the most important lines in the book of Job is, I know that my Redeemer lives and that on the earth he's going to stand. And you think, that, well, how long ago was this? Well, this is Abraham's time. Job is one of Abraham's peers. So we have a God-man, and he was not just surprising everybody on the pages of the New Testament before the foundation of the world. He was chosen to become our Savior, and he was going to take on flesh. So we have in flesh, incarnate God, to live as one who helps us in our sin, and that would be what Hebrews 4 helps us with. He becomes, he understands. So the human being, Jesus, physically died, was buried, rose from the death, ascended to his Father's side to one day return. And Scripture tells us where he was during these events. Can I just say this? Anytime you ask a question, what happens after I die? You need to go and check out Jesus first. Don't go making up something that you need to check out. Well, what happened with Jesus? Because he is our first fruits. He is the one who defies death. He's the one who makes sense of the enemy and actually ultimately destroys it. He takes it and he whips it to death and he makes it, he becomes the victor. So we need to pay attention not just to the fact that we're made in the image of God and not just the fact that we have a pattern of someone who has become human, gives us help with that, but, and this is an amazing verse, and I want you to read it with me. I'm going to get you to read it. I think the reading, public reading of God's word is powerful, and I want you to think about it. Here's how I want you to think about it. In the normal sense of what Paul is saying to Timothy about how we understand about life and the future. All right, so this is going to help us understand so that I could probably close my book and go home after we read this. So let's read it together. You always read the passage where it's found first. 2 Timothy 1, 9, 10. God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished or destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Did you get that last line? I need to tell you, this, I need to give my husband credit. I'm battling through this saying, Gary, I've got it this, I've got that. I just want to be made, I want... Because what people say is, well, the idea of immortality is made up or imposed on. And he said, well, you need to read 2 Timothy, and you need to read what it says about the gospel and what the gospel does. And this is what this is saying. Well, does somebody know what it's saying? In terms of how do I understand life before death, after death, and immortality, according to these verses? Through the gospel. It's the gospel that shines into my heart. The whole new covenant ministry. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, just at the end of the chapter, right through the chapter 7, is all about the gospel and the opening of my eyes and the transformation that takes place so that I see who Jesus is. So what he's saying is this. The appearing, that's just another word for revelation of Christ Jesus, who abolished death, and he brought life and immortality to light. It doesn't say he created it or he's going to show it, let it show up at some point. He brought it to our understanding. We finally understood, no, we are made for eternity. Now, you don't prove it from the book of Ecclesiastes, because that's Solomon in a bad mood. Really, as interesting it is, as he's just saying, don't go and do what I did, folks. And he's talking about the death of the body. But Paul is saying, listen, what does the gospel do? When you come, and I did it in 1957, and I bowed my knee, not any credit to me, but all credit to the Lord Jesus and to the Spirit of God who worked in me to see him for who he was as my Savior, someone who propitiates God. He satisfies God's anger against my personal sin. Not in a general way, so y'all come now and everybody's saved. No, it's my personal sin that my Savior took. So when I understand the gospel, my eyes are open to what life is all about prior to and after death. And immortality, and you won't understand it until you understand the gospel. So those are the three things I want to kind of encourage you to think this morning before we do our notes, that it is the gospel that opens up our minds. So let's go to our notes, and I've got to keep an eye on the time. Well, you could read these particular quotes, but I think, let's see, I would like to say the last one I'm going to read. Everything we believe about death, life after death, heaven and hell is related in some way to the death and resurrection of Christ. Death is real, but Christ has defeated death. Human beings exist in some form after death because Jesus himself existed with the Father. The Christian hope is resurrection, not bodiless life after death. And our resurrection bodies will be like Christ. So there's a lot more that you can read in some of these books. Well, let me go ahead and follow through to try and give you some kind of a basis to be thinking about death and life and immortality. Basic hermeneutics. So context is everything. Let me suggest to you that we're not going to get into a debate on what are we calling the inside person. Look, if you start reading people, everybody has a different opinion. You're dual, you're triple. Then you start reading the Bible, which is a good place to start, and you find out there are a number of words that context is in terms of how we use words like soul. So I've chosen to remind you that when Mary spoke, she said, my soul. So she talks about the inside as her soul. When Jesus talked, he said, you have to love the Lord your God with your heart and your mind and then your soul. So there was something else going on. When Paul talks, he says soul, spirit, and body. So here's what I would like to recommend. If you want to, this isn't being reductionistic, but it is saying there is a mystery here. There are many words that are used. And so in different contexts, different words are used for a purpose to give us a slice of look in that particular way. It doesn't mean they're competing, the soul and the spirit and the mind. Every thought. Captive to the mind of Christ. So what we're saying is, bottom line, man is immaterial and material. This you can touch. The real me right now is still here with you. If I were to have a heart attack and fall down and die, I would be gone. Now my body would still be here. You'd have to do something with it. But I would be gone. So that's the important part in terms of how we're made in the image of God. And some of these books will help you with that in terms. Look, if you go back to the quote, the first quote, the biblical writers used many expressions to describe the immaterial aspect of human nature. A biblical approach on distinguishing the intricacy of the human being affirms the complexity of human nature. We cannot be neatly divided into parts. There are full-page charts on how the soul, spirit, body, and how they, you know what, then you've got to have the heart and the mind, and then you've got to have the kidneys. Because in Jewish thinking in the Old Testament, the bowels were the place you felt. So you can't go and necessarily make this a nice little chart more than you can just say there are different words. We're called to love the Lord our God with our whole heart. That is, The whole of us, body and soul, or body and insides, are to be devoted to him. And you can see the difference in terms of, or some of the terms that are used. Now, there are also, and I've already mentioned this, many words, single focus. The material and immaterial part is combined here. So that the literary devices come in, the different personalities will use different terms, and God uses that. Third focus, and we've said this already, Jesus is the focus. What happens to Jesus happens to the believer. So I'm going to suggest to you, when Jesus was on the cross, well, I'm not going to suggest it, the Bible teaches it. And, well, before he goes, the thief on the cross says, they have an argument. Imagine having an argument when you're in deepest pain. Terrible, horrific, scandalous torture. And they're having a discussion about whether they should be on the cross or not. And whether he should. And of course, the thief on the cross that understands turns to Jesus and says, I believe you're not. Well, I want you to remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus says, you know what? In about 2,010 years, you'll be able to, we'll be able to get this program on the road. I'm really serious. He does not. He says, and it does matter where the comma is. Today, you'll be with me. He doesn't say, the Greek does not say, and he said today, comma. So he's saying it today. He said, comma, today you'll be with me in paradise. All right, so where, then he says to the Father, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. You guys, you need to come to grips with what the Bible says. That's what it says. And if you're reading it in the normal sense, you're going to say, great news. Jesus is my paradigm in terms of he's the final word. And if he's with the Father at the moment of physical death, and he is the one who leads us, and we follow in his train, the promise, as Paul will later say, is absent from the body, present with the Lord. So he becomes, keep your eyes focused on him. And then finally, apply the principles. And so we're going to do that right now. So let me conclude here, and then we'll finish up with some of these other comments. To be made in the image of God, we reflect in our soul. God, this is how we reflect God. Volitional, we're able to choose. Intellectual, we're able to think. Unlike animals, well, they can think, but it's a little bit rote. I mean, Pavlov's dog is a very good example of someone who could be taught to do some pretty interesting things at the moment of when, I don't remember how he got the saliva to come, but it was through the food, wasn't it? Do y'all remember that? Yeah. Well, your dog can be taught a lot of tricks, but they can't necessarily expand beyond what you are working, because they're not human beings. And emotional, able to love and express love, it sets us apart. Sets us apart as made in God's image. Sets us apart who are made for eternity. And we have ample witness. So here's what Scripture speaks. I have tried to imagine or question, give some of the questions you might have here. There are some people who will say, here's what we've done with post-death so we can cope with it. We would like to postpone it. So there's reincarnation. If you go to India, you will see the caste system well modeled. You'll see the sweepers. But basically, it's wicked in that it's a nation in bondage. When I came back from India, I realized this is a nation in bondage to reincarnation, because it's the way you keep people from moving. What a lie. Postponing facing God. You don't ever have to face God as long as you keep coming back as something else, even if it's a dolphin. No, I think that's the highest on the little thing for some of the people. And then soul sleep comes into this here. So there's a non-responsible act. I can go into the grave and somehow, where in the world is an eternal person sleeping? I mean, where are they? You don't go into nonness. And so the postponement of facing God becomes very important here. Now, I understand you know, some of you know way more about that than I do. But it isn't logical if you're going to take the scripture and apply the scripture to it, because it doesn't make sense, because Jesus didn't go into some little cabinet, his real person, or float around in the universe until it was time 3 days later for his body to come back. He was with the Father. All right? Purpose. They propose fanciful options. You can become angels. I was just at my neighbor's funeral, and my neighbor is supposed to apparently be floating around my neighborhood and in and out of her husband's kitchen. I don't think that's a good choice. That's hopeless. That's not conscious of ultimate joy or the torment that we're told those who are cast into hell face. Or they're privy to God's mysteries. The Gnostics were big about this. Out-of-body experiences. Deny future existence. Make unbiblical guarantees. Islam says if you go and blow up or whatever you die for, you have men, not women, by the way, you are going to have, I think they promise 70 virgins. Right. Mormons promise a whole planet where you can make babies forever. I can't imagine anything more taxing than that. And then create. Now, look, I haven't got an exhaustive list here. There's lots of ideas of what happens after death. Create intermediate requirements, purgatory, that sort of thing. One of the things I'd like to recommend to you is that you take a quick look at history. Let me just give you a quick of what has happened over the last 2,000 years on what people believe or where people believe after the person, and I'm calling them a person because that's what they are, goes after death. Basically, for the first 5 centuries, there was still the Orthodox belief that you were absent from the body, present with the Lord, or Luke 16, the story of the parable where the rich man in hell lifts up his eyes, he's in hell, he's conscious, and he says, could you just get me a drink? Or could you go and tell my brothers not to come to this place? And there's some very important theological teaching in that parable that Jesus told. Just because it's a parable doesn't mean it's not teaching truth. Be careful that you don't get sucked into that lie. And then the Lazarus, the beaten up old poor man who's eating crumbs, is in another word that's one of those many words that means with God, the Abraham bosom, the Old Testament more picture. He is conscious of safety and bliss. So that was basically a commitment the church made until Origen caused the first major challenge. And his basic thing was not so much in annihilationism or soul sleep or where do they go, no hell, but universalism. God's a God of love, so everybody's going to eventually come. So there was a great outcry and an establishment of anathemas. He had 7 anathemas, I believe, 7, at least a few, and that's just a curse. If you don't believe, and I copied it out, and I thought I would read it to you, but anyway, I'm going to just, yeah, I'll just leave it. What they said that he is anathema. This is not true. This is, all will not be saved, and it was up until the Reformation and during the time of Jonathan Edwards, even in America, where we were still having statements, strong statements, confirming the fact that there is a place we go to following death, believers and unbelievers. And Albert Mohler has made a very good point where he has said this, the doctrine of eternal punishment. And ladies and gentlemen, that's the issue. It's the issue in the emergent church right now. If you read Rob Bell, Elvis, if you read any stuff coming out of Brian McLaren's mouth, the move away from total depravity that we deserve. That's what we deserve. It's our default position, as it were. Apart from God's grace pulling us, that whole mood, that's going to be a battle that the church is going to face, and it's facing it now. The doctrine of eternal punishment is the watershed between evangelical and non-evangelical thought. And so you have to be able to think clearly. What am I going to be thinking in terms of historically? Because if you move 17th century, think about 18th century, you're moving through into the Enlightenment, people becoming very skeptical. In the 1980s, the Jesus Seminar, we're going to bleach Jesus of all his deity and his supernatural power, so he doesn't become a powerful model for us in terms of defying death and the resurrection. And so we have a crisis, I think, even on our hands right now. And I mean, I could mention some names like Stott, John Stott, who had in the 80s came to say, this is what, well, there will be hell and then there will be annihilation because God is so kind, he wouldn't let people suffer forever. Now, I'm just saying, these are the ways that people are thinking to diminish the everlasting punishment that the Word of God talks about. Some very great men over the years, Ken Conser, Carl Henry, Jim Packer, that have helped us deal with that. So let's talk about the truth then of God, God's truth about man's past. We're called to love the Lord our God with our whole inside and outside, all right? That's a given. Number two, we have entered into the new covenant because I would think you'd want to be sure where you're going when you die. If, in fact, in this room you are professing to be a believer in Jesus Christ. It's not a good thing to not think through. I need to tell you, I sat with a lady on Thursday, and I had a discussion with her about where she's going to go. Tell me when you came to Christ. Well, when I joined the church. Well, what will happen when you die? Well, I'm hoping. That's not good enough when we know that Jesus Christ comes and says, My sheep hear my voice, and they follow me, and I give to them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Those are promises our hearts hold on to. So we're taken, look under A, from death to new life. So I'm going to just go through these. You can look at them at a later time. We are spiritually dead from birth, number one. We're unfit for heaven. Listen, can I just say this? I have some family not going to heaven, and this bugs them. Why would you want to go to heaven and live with Jesus when you don't even talk about him or to him on earth? I mean, it seems so foolish to me that people would expect to go to be where Jesus is when they haven't wanted anything to do with him in a whole lifetime. Does that make sense to you? Okay, doesn't to me either. Humankind's default destination is hell, not heaven. We deserve it. We don't deserve heaven. That's why it's grace that we have in Christ. And then we have a hell. There is a hell. And I don't know if you know this, but you might. Jesus spoke about it more than anybody else. And there is hope for hell-bound sinners. I have a friend who is a pastor in this church, Jeannie Osterberg, and she just says, we're all dirty, rotten sinners. And some people don't like that word, that phrase. We're dirty, rotten sinners, and Jesus came to clean us up and to make us white in the righteousness of Christ so that we're ready to be put in heaven and to go to heaven. Second part of this is we're given promises. It's real. It's still an enemy, but Christ has defeated it, and we exist in some form after death. Now, Daniel is one of the first in the Old Testament that mentions that. Remember, he's having his visions, and he says he came to a point, and the angel said to him, calm down, Daniel, calm down. You want to know everything, and you can't know it until the end. But for a long time, there's going to be dust. Their bodies are going to become dust. And they're going to be resurrected. In the Old Testament, that's its way of describing death. And it's going to be they're going to be resurrected to eternal life, same word, or eternal death. And you know, if you have one, if you want heaven to be eternal, you can't argue whether hell is eternal. You can't have both ways. You can't talk out of both sides of your mouth. It isn't logical, and it isn't the normal way of interpreting a sentence. So Daniel gives us that. Now, here's some models. Think about this, just as you think about post-death experience. Enoch walked with God, and he was not. You ever thought about where did his body go? You know what? We're not told. Those are things we're not told. We do know he went, he was with God walking, and then all of a sudden, he was not, and that means he wasn't down here, but he was there. All right? So he was not. I always think, what did his wife say when he didn't come home for dinner that night? Number two, Moses, he died, and he was buried. And we know that from Jude because they argued over his bones. Boy, Satan, don't ask me why. I mean, you might have a reason. Wanted to get hold of those bones. And where do we see Moses? Ladies and gentlemen, we see Moses in the New Testament in the Transfiguration. And it is Moses that the disciples recognize. There's Moses and Elijah. That's our third model, who was caught up in a chariot. All I'm trying to say is the post-death of these, our brothers who've gone ahead of us, is not that they are sleeping and not that they are passive and neutral. They are in an active conversation with the Lord Jesus about the glory, this the glory, the unusual glory of the cross that's going to come as he takes our sin. And then, of course, the famous story about Lazarus and the rich man, we've commented on that. So we have an understanding of people where we know where they are following death. That's a lesson we learn from the Bible. There's no mystery. We know where they are. Second thing is, from earth to heaven. So let me just go through these. At death, Christ followers know one thing. Jesus is the life. So he's still alive. And I already went through some of these. Remember Luke in paradise? So these are just other descriptions. When we're talking about a variety of topics, such as the big broad word hell, you have variety of words that are under it as a description that fit under it like an umbrella. When you have the word heaven, you have other pictures, paradise with God, with Christ, present with the Lord, at home with the Lord. And so you have all these many variety. They're not different meanings. They're different pictures, like a kaleidoscope. You turn one and you see, oh, I never saw it that way before. In fact, Jesus' discussion with Martha was a great theological instruction on what happens after life. Now here's, I'd like you just to turn there because we've got just a few minutes and I want to finish before you eat lunch. Well, you could eat lunch and I could keep on, but you aren't going to be here. Just go ahead and turn to John chapter 11, and I want you to see what Jesus says to Martha. Could I just say, I love Martha. I also love Mary, because I think I'm schizophrenic. I've got two parts of me. I love sitting and listening with the Lord, and then I love to get up and have a very spirited argument or discussion, and that's what she, think of some two of the most spirited discussions in the New Testament were by two women. The Samaritan woman wanted to argue about where you should be worshiping God, remember, when Jesus came through Samaria? And then here's Martha. She was always willing to take Jesus on, which was an interesting thing to me. So here we are, chapter 11, and he says, verse 24, Martha said, I know he's going to rise in the resurrection. Her theology was right. It was just not complete. I know he's going to rise in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection. Can you see when you're made in the image of God, life never goes somewhere where you don't know where it's going. Existence and eternal life, eternal life is a form of existence, but it's bliss. Damnation, suffering and torment is a form of existence. And so here's what he said that I think we need to hear. Whoever believes in me, who is life, though he die, yet shall he live. That means when my body's dead, I want to tell you, I think Moody said it. If you hear that I've died, don't believe it. I'm more alive than ever. I'm kicking around heaven, checking out the spaces, looking, meeting the people, taking a great long drink at my Savior. Could I just encourage you, one of the solutions for your concerns about after death, if you just sit and be quiet, take a look at the Savior, you would be so jealous of those who've already gone ahead. Try and figure out not to commit suicide, but how can I get there faster? Why? Because though he dies, yet he shall live. And now look at the other side. This is parallelism. Everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. The real me, the real you, never dies. You see, that's why, I'm not going to get into the second death in Revelation, but that's what he's saying to her. Listen, you have a dead brother, but it's his body that's dead. And I'm going to bring him back. And she's going to argue about that too. He's stinky. We don't want him around right now. We need to wash him up first. No. He's going to come back to life. So this is very important in terms of the post-death experience. Well, let's tie it up with the last four, and then I want to play a very quick, convicting clip for you from an atheist. from heaven to earth for heaven. Now, how do we know we can know? Because we have a Savior who came. He's the only one who came from heaven. By the way, the Mormons are not right. You didn't start as a spirit in heaven. You started as a twinkle in your mother's eye or your father's eye, somebody's eye. Okay? You didn't start and then come. Only Jesus. He's the only human being who lived in heaven before coming, becoming human. He knew more about heaven than anyone else. It's not a state of mind. It's a real spiritual realm. Our hope is the resurrection, number four. And I've tried to define that for the church. There's a catching up, 1 Thessalonians says, that's different to the Matthew 24 of the Advent, when Jesus' feet arrive on Mount of Olives. You need to come to grips with important terms. And when there's a coming to the air, that's different than the coming to the ground. So whether you believe the rapture is going to start right away, soon as we want, or as soon as we hope, or whether you think it's going to be in the middle of the tribulation or at the end of the tribulation, you know, I'm not going to argue with, I'm a pre-trib girl myself, but I'm not going to argue with you about that, but I am going to argue that he's going to catch up his bride, and then he's going to come back, and his feet are going to land. And the point is that the resurrection, if the rapture occurs, my body's going to be transformed after my mother's is risen. So the dead in Christ are going to rise first. They're persons, their soul, spirit, heart, mind, the unseen part of them is going to come back with Jesus and be united. And we will be, as whole people, finally, forever with the Lord. So at the rapture, at the resurrection, they will come, my father, my mother, now my sister-in-law. I got a lot of people going on ahead of me who, when the resurrection happens, their bodies are going to rise and meet their immaterial person. They're going to come with Jesus. They're caught up. We mentioned that. Our bodies will be like Christ. That's the big deal, ladies and gentlemen. On any answer you want is that you, well, what's Christ? What is Christ experiencing? What did Christ experience? That's, we will be like him, for we'll see him as he is. Our body will be changed. So finally, earth to hell. At death, this is what the Bible teaches. Unbelievers go to hell. Jesus is coming, first for believers, deliverers, but he's coming to judge. So there will be a judgment day. It is appointed unto man once to die, and then after that, the judgment. Hell itself is a severe apartness from God. But that isn't the final judgment. God is going to not let a person stay anonymously judged forever. He's going to say, come up here. And I have family who doesn't know Jesus. And they're going to come, and if they don't know him, they're going to stand. Do you know my father was one of eight brothers and sisters? And he's the only one that trusted Jesus that we know of. They're going to stand. And what's the question? Here's the question. What did you do with me? What did you think about me? That's the question. So there's a final judgment after the glory appearing. We call it the great white throne judgment. Jesus is going to be human. He's going to stand before them as the resurrected, unblemished lamb that John saw in the book of Revelation. And then the eternal home for God's people is the new heaven, and the lost will consciously exist under God's judgment forever. So what do we do with this? In terms of who you are as a Christian, can I give you the good news? The good news is, when I am absent from the body, I'm present with the Lord. That's the good news. I don't know why we would preach the gospel. The whole chapter of 1 Corinthians 15 says, if we have no resurrection, our faith is in vain. It's in vain. The second thing is, what about, I don't know, maybe you don't know Christ. I want to tell you, you need to come today. You need to trust Christ today. Your sin is the problem. And if long as that sin is unjudged, you have a choice. You can either accept the payment of Christ on the cross, judging for your sin, or you can say, you know what, I think I'd like to pay for it myself. And I need to tell you, I've spoken to two people in my life who have said to me, I'm not going to let somebody else pay for my sin. And they, up until now, I know they have no assurance of the forgiveness of sin. So that is future in a nutshell. I think, of course, there's lots of things that we could talk about. I tried to give you with the scripture what the scripture has said. If you have other questions, we could talk about it at lunchtime. I don't know if there are. There's no time for questions. But would you be patient with me and let you see this video? I probably haven't answered everything, and I'm sorry that there was a lot that I had to say, and I think if you take it home, let's continue the dialogue. But let's not hate people enough not to say anything. So figure out that Gideon Bible, I'm familiar, little red ones. Praise God for the Gideon Bibles around the world. Lord Jesus, we bow before you and we thank you that you have made it possible for us to know you and to be accepted, adopted by your Father. He's included us in the family. So that when you said to those scared disciples, don't let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me, because in my Father's house are many dwelling places. And I'm going to go, and then I'm going to come back and get you. And thank you that when we die, the body dies, we don't live a scared life fritting around the universe or out of consciousness, but we are consciously with you. Thank you for Paul. Thank you for the words he wrote, for John, for you, Lord Jesus, for writing and telling us that we do not have to be afraid. You are the resurrection and the life. Even though we die, we live. Pray that will harness us to your heart. It will get us to be not afraid to give whatever it is of your word to those people that you're putting right straight in front of us. And help us to do it with kindness, as we've already heard in your name.